Good morning, everyone. So glad to have you with us this morning. Really, really love the fact that there are people watching, our online service from kind of all around, and that makes us very happy. So glad that people are able to take advantage of this at this time. I'm very thankful for the technology that we're able to do this. So I want to lead us in prayer here as we begin, but2021 has it was supposed to be all everything was supposed to be all better. And this has kind of been a hard week. It's been a tough week, for different people, for our country. And I talk to people. I talk to people, that I know. I talk to people around the country. I talk to people in other countries. And one thing I have noticed is there's a lot of pain in this world right now. Are you noticing the same thing? Maybe you're noticing it in yourself. Okay. I just find that there's a lot of pain. My good friend Kevin Vance in Saskatchewan, he's a minister there, and he's finding that overdoses are incredibly, they have gone up like tenfold in that part of the world, and I think it's true around. There's been a lot of repercussions this last year that have been hard on us, and so my response is it shows us how very much we need God. We need God right now. You need God. I need God. We need God. And so I want to pray. And I kind of want to strike a balance between, I don't want to be depressed about this. At the same time, I don't want to be tone deaf about what's going on in our world. And I want to be able to go to God with that. So let's go to God. Father, we bow before you, the maker of heaven and earth, the king of everything, and we just so glad that we have you as our Father and Jesus Christ as our Master and Lord and the Holy Spirit living inside of us. Oh, all of that is just so good. Lord, we need you. We need your help. We all know of people that are needing you in their lives. And Lord, you know that we struggle sometimes and we kind of will focus on other things and we will find other ways of escape and other ways of kind of soothing the pain. But so often, Father, as you know, those solutions actually make things worse. So we just bow before you, Father, asking you to fill us with your spirit, fill us with your love. May we feel your presence in our lives. And Father, now as we go forward in this service of worshiping you, may our hearts be inclined towards you and your love. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Before the throne of God above, I have a strong and perfect plea, a great high priest whose name is love, whoever lives and pleads for me. My name is graven on his hands, my name is written on his heart. I know that while in heaven he stands, no tongue can bid me thence depart. No tongue can bid me thence depart. When Satan tempts me to despair and tells me of the guilt within, upward I look and see him there, who made an end to all my sin. Because a sinless Savior died, my
my sinful soul is counted free, for God the just is satisfied to look on him and pardon me, to look on him and pardon me. Behold him there, the risen Lamb, my perfect spotless righteousness, the great unchangeable I am, the King of glory and of grace. One with himself I cannot die, my soul is purchased by his blood, my life is hid with Christ on high, with Christ my Savior and my God, with Christ my Savior and my God.
How do you explain? How do you describe a love that goes from east to west and runs as deep as it is wide? You know all our hopes, Lord, you know all our fears, and words cannot express the love we feel, but we long for you to hear. So listen to our heart,
O Lord, listen.
Hear our spirit sing,
and hear us sing
a song of praise,
a simple song of praise
from those you have redeemed. To tell you what an awesome God you are, but words are not enough to tell you of our love. So listen to our hearts. If words could fall like rain from these lips of mine, and if I had a thousand years, still run out of time. If you listen to my heart, every beat will say, thank you for the life, thank you for the truth, thank you for the way. So listen to our heart, praise,
a simple song of praise
from those you have redeemed.
Those you have redeemed.
We will use the words we know to tell you what an awesome God you are. But words are not enough to tell you of our love. So listen to our hearts. But words are not enough to tell you of our love, so listen to our hearts.
In the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise, give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. You can have all this world, but give me Jesus. And when I am alone, oh, and when I give me Jesus, give me Jesus. You can have all this world, but give me Jesus. And when I come to die, oh, and when I come to die, and when I come to die, give me Jesus, give me Jesus, give me Jesus. You can have all this world, you can have all this world, oh, you can have all this world, but give me Jesus.
You know, a few years ago, I was attending a football game in South Carolina. It was South Carolina against Tennessee. And, you know, it's kind of a big SEC game. And anyway, we had fairly decent seats. We were fairly low. And but there were some Tennessee fans sitting right in front of us. And the Tennessee band wasn't too far from us. So didn't like that too much. But, you know, there's only so much a Rocky Top I can take. But I think, you know, my behavior at a game is perfectly fine, okay? I don't have any problems with how I behave. But here we are at this game, and it was the beginning, and I think the Tennessee players were coming out, and chances are pretty good I was booing. I'm trying to be mean. I'm just... But the lady that was sitting right in front of me, she turns around and she says to me, "Don't be tacky." don't be tacky? Like, first of all, who says tacky? Okay, all right. But second of all, I want to be tacky. And third of all, who are you telling me how I'm supposed to behave? So the rest of the story is I calmed it down a little bit. I didn't do things to kind of get back at her for that. I didn't. But I still did my normal thing. So the truth is, and this is kind of my point, I don't like to be scolded. Do you? I just don't. And I think, you know, I don't think it's a male thing. I think it's a human thing. We just don't like to be told things like that. Okay? So, Ephesians chapter 6, Paul is going to speak pretty straight. And he is talking, the subject is slavery. And he's going to talk straight, both to slaves and to masters. And I'm here to say that I really don't think either one of them, at least at the beginning, would have liked what he had to say. So in this part of Ephesians that we've kind of been working through, Paul addresses three groups of people. Okay, but he starts in chapter 5, verse 21 with this statement. Submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. Okay, so that's what he's saying. Submit to one another. Be submissive. Christianity is about submission. It is not about domination. Okay, that's what he is teaching. But then from there, he goes on, he takes three groups that come out on the bottom of society in his day, and we still struggle with some of the things that he said. So the three groups that he takes are wives, children, and slaves. And instead of calling for liberation, he calls for submission. Okay? Straight on. He does. With all three groups, he does this. Because Paul is trying to teach that Christianity is about submission. It's not about domination. So Paul writes five verses here in Ephesians chapter 6 that probably pleased no one. Now, they may have enjoyed what he was saying to, you know, about the other, but did not enjoy what he said about them. But Paul said it anyway. I think Paul knew that. I don't believe any of this would have caught Paul off guard. He knew that what he was saying was going to be hard for people to read. As we open here in verse 5, I imagine that slaves felt somewhat deflated when they first read these words. All right, so let's work through this part. Slaves, obey your earthly masters with respect and fear, and with sincerity of heart, just as you would obey Christ. Obey them not only to win their favor when their eye is on you, but as slaves of Christ, doing the will of God from your heart, serve wholeheartedly as if you were serving the Lord, not people. Because you know that the Lord will reward each one for whatever good they do, whether they are slave or free. Now, imagine that you are a slave and you are hearing this. Now, I think we can look at this and we'll take certain parts and that's fine. But a slave is hoping that the word of God is going to set them free. That's what I want. I want to be free. And Paul does not say that. He does not say, all right, slaves, you know, I'm going to show you how to escape, how to get away, how that you can be okay. He doesn't say that. What he says is, obey your earthly masters. He says, respect and fear. You are obeying, and you know, slaves were kind of well known, have always been kind of well known for kind of doing the least that they could do, the bare minimum, and to do it, you know, only when they're watching. And he addresses all of this. Don't do that. Be truly submissive. Truly submit your will to the will of your earthly master. And I just think, Are you kidding? But he's not. He's not kidding. He's not kidding at all. And you need to show them respect and fear with sincerity of heart. So what I was saying earlier, the way, you know, they just kind of, if you're looking, yes, master, I'll do whatever. But as soon as you turn your back, it's like, oh, go away. You know, I'm not doing that. And he says, you need to obey them like you obey Christ. Strong words, not just when they're looking, but as slaves of Christ. You are a slave of Christ. I don't want to be a slave of anybody. And Paul says you are not only a slave to your master, but you are also a slave to Christ. And can you hear the confrontation of their hearts and the word of God? As the word of God is coming at them, and Paul is preaching us, not to be mean, not to be harsh, but just to be truthful. Doing the will of God from your heart. Serve wholeheartedly as if you were serving the Lord. And you would not do that to the Lord. When you're serving the Lord, you don't sit there and wait till he turns around and then you just, you know, I'm not doing any of this. That's not how you treat Jesus. And what he's saying is, treat your slave master the same way. Oh my goodness. And then he says down here in verse 8, because you know that the Lord will reward you. I know this looks like, you're getting nothing out of this. And slavery, particularly in this country, was, you know, I mean, sometimes there was this rhetoric about, hey, well, the slaves got treated well. They were treated like family. And, you know, and like, no, that's crazy talk. You're talking about people that lived in their home, Africa, the continent of Africa, and slave traders would go over there and capture them. And yes, they got help from other Africans. That's true. But you were basically kidnapping people and just shoving them into ships and take them across the Atlantic Ocean to a whole nother country, a whole nother continent that is not their home, and selling them. People that you just grabbed, you are now selling, and they get up in the morning and they work. They go to bed at night and they go to sleep. They wake up in the morning and they work. And that's just the way it is. And they're getting nothing out of it. And I do want to say this. Do you realize Africa is a nice place? I think sometimes we kind of look almost like we did them a favor. We didn't do them a favor. Africa is a very nice place. I've been there 3 times. I've spent 2 summers there in South Africa. Did a side trip into Zimbabwe. I've spent a week in Tanzania. I love Africa. The truth is, when Laura and I got married, we were planning to move to Africa. And that didn't work out. Really, it didn't work out financially. And I'm just going to tell you, ever since then, there has been a piece of sadness inside of me, because I truly believe that I would have loved being a missionary there and growing up and living in Africa and raising a family in Africa. I think we would have really enjoyed it. I think it would have been a good life. So this is what, you know, in a little bit more closer to us than the New Testament. That's what slavery was. But you know that the Lord will reward you. The rewards of this life had really escaped slaves. They were low on the totem pole. There was nothing good. But Paul is saying, the Lord knows how to reward you. And he will reward you for the good you do. It doesn't matter if you're slave or free. It doesn't matter. The rewards from God are plentiful. And when you get to heaven, there's not going to be a slave part and a not slave part. We're going to all be together. And so while Paul is saying, you know, you need to learn to submit, he also says, please don't forget that your Father knows how to reward you. And he will. Now, when we get to verse 9, then comes masters. And masters, treat your slaves in the same way. Do not threaten them, since you know that he who is both their master and yours is in heaven, and there is no favoritism with him. I think reading and listening through verse 8, the slave masters would have thought, great, this Paul is a great guy. Like what he's saying. That all makes sense. Yes, that's true. Amen, brother. Amen, brother. Preach on. Well, they probably shouldn't have said preach on, because when you get to verse 9, Paul says, okay, you masters, I'm going to tell you the truth too. And they're not going to like it. So like I said, nobody's liking this. Treat your slaves in the same way. What do you mean the same way? You treat them, all the things that I just said to the slaves, you need to do the same thing. Remember, we're still talking about submitting to one another out of reverence for Christ. And while the slave owners would think, well, that doesn't apply to us, Paul says it does too apply to you. How you treat your slaves matters. And you need to treat them the same way you would treat Christ. Now you tell me. Does that undermine slavery? Absolutely it does. It kind of does it a little bit through the back door, but it absolutely, you cannot treat your slaves like you would treat Christ, and they're still your slaves. You just can't do that. Do not threaten them. Do not threaten them. A slave master, well then what am I supposed to do? You don't understand, Paul. Maybe you don't understand how things work in the real world. Because slavery without threats, it doesn't work. But he says, you know that both their master and yours, you have the same master. You are the earthly master in this setting, but you both have a master that's in heaven, right? Right. And there's no favoritism with him. So he looks at you, the slave master, and he looks at your slave, and there is no hierarchy. This is the point to slavery, this hierarchy. There has to be this hierarchy, that we are the people that are higher. And whatever that might be based on, whether that be based on economics, based on race, whether that based on just where you were born, that has to be there in order for slavery to work. But it's not there with God. God doesn't see all that stuff. All that stuff that we have that sort of separates us as people, as some people being higher and other people being lower, that's not from God. God doesn't see it that way. So, you know, here's the thing that the slave owners would hear, and that Paul did say, that slaves no longer belong to their owners. They did not really serve them. They did not merely do their will, and they did not seek to please them, and they were no different from them. This is all the things that Paul is saying. And so Paul speaks very straight to the slaves and very straight to their masters. And this is kind of the point that I'm trying to talk about today. It's not so much an analysis of slavery, an analysis of racism, an analysis of class systems in our society. What I'm really talking about today is, do you let God talk to you like that? The things that are in your life that you really don't want to talk about, you'd rather just kind of skirt over them. Do you let God bring those things up? I personally think that we all like to replace this with God talking to them. You know, in the TV series Lost, very, very interesting series, but in that series, you know, there was the passengers from the flight that had crashed, and they were kind of, you know, rallying together and surviving and trying to figure out what to do. But eventually, you know, spoiler alert, they find out that there's other people on the island. And you know what they called them? The Others. That's what they were called. Throughout the show, they were called the Others. I feel like as Christians, sometimes that's kind of how we see the rest of the world. They're the Others. And that's who we want God to address. Talk to them, Father. Tell them all the things that they do wrong. In a sense, we close ourselves off. It's like, God, don't talk to me, talk to them. They're worse than me, and they need your word. That's who needs to hear from you. You know, I'm okay. I'm good. That's just not what we find in this passage. What we find is, We find God speaking straight to the people that are reading this, and it's good for them, and it's the truth. You and I, we need truth in our life. We need God to speak truth into our lives. And so as I look at this passage, and it's like, you know, how do I apply this passage to us today? You know, it's not like this situation has gone away. There are more slaves today than there has ever been in history. Estimates are that there are 40 million slaves today, and they are generating $150 billion annually. Do you think that's going to go away? That's not going to go away. And another issue that I always feel like is so closely tied to this is human trafficking, which is it's slavery as well. Do you know, and I know we often try to look at this as like, well, this is over in Thailand, this is over in India, this is in China. Like we like to think that that's where all this is, but it's everywhere. Do you know what is the biggest day of the year for human trafficking? This is kind of heartbreaking, but it's Super Bowl Sunday. It's estimated that there are 10,000 victims being offered Super Bowl Sunday. That hurts. So, what I'm trying to say is, the problems of the first century have not gone away. The need for God to be able to speak to us about what is going on inside of our lives, to speak to you, to speak to me, that has not gone away. We still need God to be straight with us. And so I just want to say this to you. Stop protecting yourself from the truth of God's word. Are you ever quiet enough for God to say anything to you? Do you even give him any kind of an avenue where he might speak to you and speak to your life? I had an experience a little over a year ago where, I woke up in the night and I sensed the presence of God. I don't think that's weird, because I think we are in the presence of God. But that night, it wasn't just a theoretical belief of mine, but I just felt like I could sense the presence of God. And I could sense him wanting me to speak to him and to talk to him. And I'm just going to tell you, try not to be weird here, but I was able to talk to God that night about some things that I've been needing to talk to him about for several years. And it was things that I was sort of, like I said, don't protect yourself from the truth of God's word, where I was protecting myself from the truth of God's word. And I just kind of that night just like, okay, Father, let's talk. Let's be real. I have people that I work with to hear God. At the moment, I have two groups that I meet with. And our whole agenda is to listen to God. Listening to God through prayer. Listening to God through scripture and listening to God through mission. And, I work at this, and it's interesting that, through the nutrition part of the gym this year, I was asked to come up with a word for the year, and my word was listen. And it's just interesting that, I get an email from my coach, and she just, at the end, she says, "How have you listened to God this week?" I got people from the gym asking me, "How have you listened this week?" I just think this is incredible. This is what we need. We need to position ourselves, our hearts, open them up, soften our hearts, get rid of the pride that is blocking these things, and say to our Father, "What would you say to me?" Very much like these slaves had to do that. They had to soften their hearts and open themselves up and say, "Okay, God, what would you say to me as a slave?" And God says, okay, I'm going to tell you. And the same thing with the slave masters, with their prideful and their and everything that they had that insulated them from real life. And they had to soften their hearts and open their hearts and say to God, okay, God, what do you have to say to me as a master? And God says, okay, I'll tell you what I have to say. You need to learn to listen to God through scripture, through prayer and mission. You need to learn this. I'm gonna tell you, the elders and I are working as fast as we can to get you help in this. I've mentioned it before. It's connected to Mission Alive, a group that I am on the board with. But we are doing everything we can to try to spread this as fast as we can. Because this is what you need. This is what we all need. But in order for this to work, one of the things is you must drop the notion that God is trying to make you happy. He's trying to make you holy. Do you realize that? That's why he talks straight to you. That's why in this letter, Paul talks straight to the church in Ephesus. Because he's not trying to make them happy. And I mean, they could look at what he said about slaves and what he said about masters and it's like, no, we don't like that. None of that's good. But I think Paul would be unfazed because he wasn't trying to make them happy. Just like God's not trying to make you happy. He's trying to make you holy. And he will do all kinds of things to lead you to where he wants you to be. And just as a side, I'm telling you, you can always trust him. Any place he is trying to lead you, anything he is trying to do in your life, it is good. I promise you that. In the Hebrew writer, the Hebrew writer writes this. He says, endure hardship as discipline. God is treating you as his children. For what children are not disciplined by their father? A little bit later, he says, no discipline seems pleasant at the time, but painful. Later on, however, it produces a harvest of righteousness and peace for those who have been trained by it. That's what I've been talking about this whole time, that you have got to open yourself up to God. And at times, it will seem painful, where he says things that maybe you don't want. But I'm telling you, in the end, you reap the benefit from it. God is able to speak into your life. Let him. You know, as I'm getting ready to close here, you know, I was on a Zoom call Thursday morning, and it was with a woman that works for the Wycliffe Bible Translators, and she works in Central Asia. And she was telling us a story about two Muslims that were working for her, helping her with the translation work. And we're talking about translating the Bible. And they had mentioned, they talked to her one day, and they were translating the book of Luke. And they mentioned that they had been afraid of what they would say if the police knew what they were doing. And if they ever looked on their computer and saw what was on there, you know, the Gospel of Luke. But then they helped her translate Luke chapter 12, 11 and 12. And this is what it says. When you are brought before synagogues, rulers and authorities, do not worry about how you will defend yourselves or what you will say. For the Holy Spirit will teach you at that time what you should say. And these two Muslim translators took the word of God and allowed it to penetrate them. And they just decided, okay, then we need to not be afraid, because that's what God is saying to us. Don't be afraid. And they could have said, you know, we've got to get out of here. This is too dangerous. It's not worth it. We need to quit. But the word of God penetrated the hearts of these two Muslim men and said, don't be afraid. That is the power of God's word. The word of God is confronting people all over the world. All over the world, the truth of God's word, that word that is alive and active, it's sharper than any two-edged sword. It's penetrating this world. You need to let it penetrate you. You need to let it confront you. It's a very beautiful thing. Praise God. Let's bow in prayer. Father, we offer ourselves to you. Help us to be humble, to take off our any protective walls that we have around us, anything that we're using to deflect your truth that is trying to penetrate our hearts. May we be soft-hearted and humble and open to you so that you can speak what you need to say. We trust you, Father. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Jesus, you were all to me. Why did you die on Calvary? O Lamb of God, I failed to see how this could be part of the plan. They say that you're alive again, but I saw death and every sin reach out to claim their darkest wing. How could this be part of the plan? If I could only hold your hand and touch the scars where nails were driven, I would need to feel your side where holy flesh thy spear was riven. Then I believe, only then I believe, your cruel death was part of a heavenly plan. Holy presence, holy face, a vision filling time and space. Your nearness makes my spirit race. Could this be part of the plan? I see the wounds that cause the cry from heaven, ocean, earth, and sky when people watched their Savior die. Could this be part of the plan? Reaching out to hold your hand and touch the scars where nails were driven. Coming near, I feel your side where holy flesh by spear was riven. Now I believe, Jesus, now I believe, your cruel death was part of a heavenly plan. I proudly say, with blazon cry,
we've all heard it, and we know it's true. 2020 has been a very difficult year. Some of us, it's been a personal thing. Some of us, it's just dealing with the pandemic. But for all of us, it should cause us to reflect and say, what is really important? And what we're doing today with communion symbolizes and reminds us of what is really important. When I think of one of my favorite scriptures that reminds me of what's important, I go to Romans 8. And I'd like to read the first four verses and give thanks for the bread after that. And then we'll read some more in Romans 8 and give thanks for the cup. Romans 8, 1 through 4. Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Because through Christ Jesus, the law of the sin of life, of the spirit of life, set me free from the law of sin and death. for what the law was powerless to do, and that it was weakened by the sinful nature, God did by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful man to be a sin offering. And so he condemned sin in sinful man in order that the righteous requirements of the law might be fully met in us who did not live according to the sinful nature, but according to the Spirit. Let's give thanks. Father, we give you thanks for these promises and what you did through Christ and the Holy Spirit collectively as a Trinity. We thank you that we can trust you. We thank you that we need not fear death, that our salvation is not based on what we do, but what you've done. We thank you for it. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Jesus, you were all to me. Why did you die on Calvary? O Lamb of God, I failed to see how this could be part of the plan.
Romans 8:31-39. These verses give me great comfort because they're the promises that my faith and everyone else's faith should be based upon. What then shall we say in response to this? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own Son, but gave him up for us, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Who is he that condemns? Christ Jesus, who died. More than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us. And this is the real crux of the matter. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or danger, or sword, as it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Let's give thanks for the cup. Father, what great promises we've just read about. What great promises you've made. Help us to embrace those. Help us to realize that all these other things that trouble us are not near as important as what we remember with this communion. We partake of it to remind us of your promises and what you've done and what Christ has done for us. We thank you in his name. Amen.
They say that you're alive again, but I saw death and every sin reach out to claim their darkest wing. How could this be part of the plan? If I could only hold your hand and touch the scars where nails were driven, I would need to feel your side.
Thank you so much for being with us this morning. We are so blessed and thankful to be able to come into your home and to share God's word. And we thank you, Alan, for that another wonderful lesson. We are so blessed to have Alan with us, the time that he puts in to share God's word with all of us. You know, during this time, I'm so thoughtful of the words in Psalms 125, where it talks about, as the Lord surrounds his people, as the mountains surround Jerusalem, so the Lord will surround his people both now and forevermore. And what a blessing to be able to think about that during this time. we have so much to be thankful for, and this church family has been so blessed. And we're so thankful for God and what He's done for us. I do want to remind you that we do meet on Sunday morning at 10:30. We do wear the mask and the social distancing because, like we said before, we want you to feel safe while you're here with us. And we just pray this morning that something touched your heart, whether it was the words, whether songs, whether prayer. But again, thank you for allowing us to come into your home. A few announcements. You know, I just ask that you please pray for our country at this time. So much going on. But we know as Christians, God can take care of it. Because God is far bigger than anything that we face on this earth. We all know that. And it's all about Him. It's not about us. And I'm also mindful of some people who need of our prayers. Thinking of Vince and Inez, as Vince is in the hospital with this horrible virus and some other health issues. So please keep praying for him. And lift him up in your prayers to God. Please be praying for Inez as she's not feeling well. And she wants to be there at the hospital so bad with Vince, but she can't because of everything that's going on. I'm also mindful of Jerry Hatter as he's recovering from his treatments. I'm thinking of Alan Shipman. And keep him in your prayers. Also with Bev, who's been recently diagnosed, and she is feeling better, so keep her in your prayers. Also with Lynn Maupin, who's had surgery recently, and she's still recovering, so keep her praying in your prayers as well. Be praying for our missionaries. They face so much each and every day, some more than others. They have remained faithful and strong to God, and we're thankful for that. Also was thankful of Eddie and Tina Foran as they have been diagnosed with COVID. Please keep them in your prayers. And I know there are others in need of our prayers and I've missed, but God knows who they are. So if you would, at this time, would you please bow with me? Lord, we love you. And we are so thankful that you've blessed this church family in so many ways. And we know that, Lord, you will keep your arms wrapped around us, just like you did in those words in Psalms 125. And Lord, we know that you are there, and we have the faith and the trust in you that you will provide. You always do, you always have, and you always will. Lord, I've mentioned those in either prayers. Just please comfort them, all their families, and just be with them, Lord, and just lift them up to you. I lift this church up to you, and Alan and Laura, and we are so thankful that they are with us, and all the work that Alan does. We are so blessed, and we thank you for Alfred working with our youth, and for Angie being there with him, and the time that he puts in. We are so thankful. Lord, just be with all of us. Keep your arms wrapped around us. And we love you. We praise you. It's in Jesus' name. Amen.
In the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise, give me Jesus, give me Jesus, give me Jesus. You can have all this world, but give me Jesus.